I want to tell you that under the doctrine of separation of powers, checks and balances, it is the sole responsibility of opposition to keep checks and balances on the government. That which the government is not doing right, it is the work of the opposition to provide and offer solution, to talk about it so that it is in the public domain. And the only mistake the opposition did was to fight for the cost of living. And we know the cost of living is that amount of money that an average Kenyan just needs to buy basic needs, to pay for rent, to buy food, to buy clothing, to afford education, and to afford healthcare. And that is too high. So as opposition, if dialogue fails, and the way it has failed, then the most appropriate avenue to follow always is the streets, which is enshrined in the Constitution of Kenya. It is an inherent right of every Kenyan to picket peaceably as entrenched in our Constitution. Yes.
And let's talk about the street protests. They were very violent. How do you describe it?
I can't say that the protests were violent. Why? Because every Kenyan, and you were present during this protest, you could see the way we could start in a very peaceful way. When they were taking an oath, was to protect life and to protect property. This government seems more interested in protection of property more than protection of life. Those property shall be enjoyed by the lives, not enjoyed by any other thing, but they are being protected for the lives. Therefore, protection of life is the fundamental right of the government instead of taking life. Look at, for example, the expressway, where the flower pots were more important than the lives that were being lost. You cannot kill citizens that you're supposed to take care of in the name of protecting a flower pot. You cannot say that the Chinese government came to find out why the expressway, the flower pots were destroyed, while you, as the president, you are not going even for one funeral of the Kenyan citizens that were killed by the police officers that are serving under you, that were taking orders from your government.
Stephen, this was very unfortunate, because these are the dark days that we are back in.
I went to Mombasa for a meeting, a parliamentary meeting, together with Nairobi members of parliament. Coming back at around 9 p.m., I was approached by 8 guys, the DCI officers from the DCI headquarters. What were they saying? That I'm being required to go and record a statement. I asked them over what. They told me, I will know barely. Then, with the 8 people I could not manage, I was just alone, decided to get into one of their vehicles, a Subaru, which was driven from the airport to town, from town to TRM. That is where they changed the number plate. When we reached there, they were changing the number plate there. So they handcuffed me from the airport. After that, put me in the Subaru, and then they drove towards Thika Road. And then after that, at some particular point, they went towards Kamiti. They were going round. So we reached Mwea in Kirinyaga at around 2 a.m. And I didn't know where I was, because clearly it was in the dark, until I was informed that I was at Mwea the previous day when I was in the police cell. I didn't know where I was. So having been bungled in the car, driven to Mwea in a police cell, in handcuffs, actually along the way, from TRM, they blindfolded me. When I saw that, when I asked them, why are we going towards Kamiti? So they blindfolded me, because for sure I knew that these people probably wanted to kill me. So I told them, there is no need of going far. Why don't you just finish me now? There is no need of going far, because you have everything you want to finish me. So there is no need of driving me around. Just finish me now. After that particular moment, they decided to blindfold me, drove me all the way to where we were going. And the following day, that's when I knew that I was at Mwea, when I asked one of the police officers at the station who came in the morning in my police cell. Incommunicado, they didn't want me to communicate with my family, with my advocates. They didn't even bring me food. And it was very, very shameful, because why do you need to punish me just for fighting for Kenyans? Is it only me? Will you punish all the Kenyans who are fighting for other Kenyans? Will you punish all the leaders who are fighting for all other Kenyans?
So Leto, for 3 good days I went without food, I went without water. I was only praying and I was asking myself, what am I doing in a police cell, from a presidential campaign to a police cell? What was I doing there alone? And I could not communicate to anybody, just sleeping on the floor. And the floor was also very cold. And the previous day I was not feeling well. So it was clear that we are back in the dark days. What was ringing in my mind is that Kenya has had presidents. They've come and they've gone. We had Kenyatta, he came and he went. We had Moi, he came and he went. We had Kibaki, he came and he went. All those three presidents died. We had Uhuru, came and went. And we have Ruto, he will come and he will go. So I don't see the need of him being reminded to lower the cost of living is a problem that somebody should be punished. That energy that they are using, all that energy they are using, and the resources, the public money they are using to arrest us, the fuel they are wasting, the movements they are making, all that resources, why can't they divert all that resources to Lamu, where people are being killed? To other areas where there are cattle rustlers, why can't they divert all those energies there? Government should let opposition do its work. We were not going after anybody. We are just fighting for the cost of living to be lowered, of which if they just lowered the cost of living, there would be no protest, and they were using too much force on us. Why would you arrest a member of parliament at night, take him to an unknown destination, while you can summon this member of parliament because you know he's not a flight risk? I would not leave the country. I have a constitutional mandate to perform, a constitutional role to perform on my people, the people of Mbakasi East constituency. Why wouldn't they just call me, summon me, if they needed anything from me to put to make things clear, to clarify on any other matter? So the idea of arresting leaders will not help, because leaders have been arrested before, but people fought. Along the way, some people die, but those who are alive will still fight. Along the way, some people cow, but those who are remaining will still fight. So it doesn't matter the strategies they use, the intimidation tactics they use, it doesn't matter. I remember in 2007, Ruto himself was in the same situation we are in now. He was in opposition. He was fighting for the rights of the downtrodden. He was demonstrating because it is something that he believed that was a right for the Kenyan citizens. What is he doing now? He's using the same tactics that the former government were using that failed. So he's literally planning to fail. Nothing has been addressed. Actually, 1 year in office, what we can celebrate is the many travels that this government has made abroad. But nothing else. The other day I was seeing you were airing Ruto's government in 1 year. 1 year in office. But I'm so saddened because look at the health sector. The health sector itself is sick. Health is sick. Why is health sick? Increment of payment of NHIF is burdening the common mwananchi. Why would you increase NHIF on them? Why would you introduce, you divide NHIF into three? That is the Social Health Insurance Fund. And you say that after dividing that into three, then the Social Health Insurance Fund shall be managed by a private sector. So you literally saying as a president that public fund should be managed by private individuals. That is completely out. The primary health sector, number two. And the third one is the emergency and the chronic funds. With these three, you are literally increasing the administrative cost. When you increase the administrative cost, what are you doing to the government? You are overburdening the common mwananchi, because that is a recurrent expenditure, cannot lead to growth of an economy. Number two, in the education sector, it is so sad, Stephen Leto, it is so sad. You and I, we are where we are because of education. I remember you are the great University of Nairobi. You are who you are as Leto because of education. Why not for education, you would have not come to Nairobi. Why not for education, I would not be a member of parliament. Why not for education, even Ruto himself, who was a beneficiary of boom, would not be where he is today. Rigathi would not be where he is today. And I can tell you for sure that during Moi's time, there used to be boom, where they were getting free funding for university. All the students who qualified for university were being admitted at 100%. They were getting boom, they were getting loans. During Kibaki's time, there was introduction of the HELB, the Higher Education Loans Board, where people were getting HELB, and there was also bursaries, and there was also extra loans in addition to that. During Uhuru's time, HELB was maintained. During these three regimes, there was 100% transition. Students were moving from high school in tunes of hundreds of thousands, joining university to pursue education. During Ruto's time is the only time where students are not joining university. There's no difference between a student who scored an A with a student who scored an E, because the student who scored an A cannot proceed because they cannot afford university fees. During Ruto's time is the only period where hundreds of thousands of students cannot join university. We are killing the education sector in this country, and we know the role of education in the economic growth of a nation by provision of skilled laborers. And in any place you go to in agriculture, they are skilled laborers. In health, they are skilled laborers. In the industries, they are skilled laborers. In every other place, they are skilled laborers. You are expecting, Leto, where you come from in Narok, where I come from in Kisumu, Nyalenda, you expect a parent who is selling vegetables, the mama mboga, the boda rider, the person who wakes up in the morning to go from Jengo. You expect that person, Leto, to part with 300,000 per year to pay for a social science course, the minimum cost. For 4 years, that person should part with 1.2 million Kenya shillings. You expect a mama mboga who makes a profit of 50 shillings per day, or even 100 shillings only, in a month that is only 3,000 Kenya shillings. In a whole year, 3,000 by 12 is 36,000 Kenya shillings. So 36,000 Kenya shillings as a profit, where will you get 1.2 million to pay for 4 years? Stephen Leto, this is quite unfortunate. We are killing the education in this nation, education that has made Ruto who he is, education that has made Rigathi who he is, education that has made Stephen Leto and Babu Owino who they are. So I can say that we've destroyed completely education in this country. Then we go to agriculture. Today, if you go to the universities, you will find the students are not in a position to join. We are told that there are only 45,000 students who will benefit, who will be given scholarship. And of these 45,000 students, Leto, there is no money for accommodation. How will they get it? While HELB used to provide for that. They used to get money from HELB. They pay a fee. The little amount remaining, they used to buy food. They get accommodation. Where will they get food? How will they move from their villages to town? So literally, we've just said that we don't want an educated nation. In agriculture, we are being told that fertilizer is being subsidized. My brother, as you subsidize fertilizer and you increase the tax on fuel. If you increase the tax on fuel, anything that is capable of being transported, the value will increase. So therefore, even the cost of transporting fertilizer from one destination to the other, the value increases. And if the value increases, that farmer will ensure that that cost, the farmer will get it back from the farm produce. So which means that there's nothing, you are doing a zero work. So by the end of the day, you will increase the fuel cost, you increase the cost of transport, and you lie to Kenyans that you're subsidizing the cost of fertilizer. But by the end of the day, the farm produce, that flour, that maize cost, will still be high. So you are not solving the cost of living. So by the end of the day, I'm a disappointed man on Ruto, a person who is educated, who is a doctor, who's advanced his education, who does not value the importance of education, having known that it is education that has brought him where he is. A person who was a minister for agriculture, having known the worth and the importance of agriculture, who walks in a farm to take photos with maize that is not ripe for harvest and telling us that this is the direction. Yes, farming is the direction, but why destroy that farming if we know that the cost of those food that is being produced will not go down?